Now we find that Paul is the one now writing to the Romans. He also was to visit Rome later on. He also was the one who knew Rome, and he's the founder of the church in Rome. Now we find that this great epistle, and the reason I feel so totally inadequate, is because of its great theme, which is the righteousness of God. And it is a message that I have attempted over the years to proclaim. And it is the message, by the way, that the world today as a whole does not want to hear it, nor will it want to accept it. The world likes to hear, friends, about the glory of mankind. It likes to have mankind exalted, not God. Now, I'm convinced in my own thinking that any ministry today that attempts to teach the glory of man and does not present the total depravity of the human heart and does not reveal that man is totally corrupt and that man is a ruined creature, that teaching that does not deal with that great truth will not lift mankind, nor will it offer a remedy, because of the fact the only remedy for man's sin today is the perfect remedy that we have in Christ, which God has provided for a lost race. And that is the great message of Romans. Now, I can illustrate that, and I want to do it in a very personal way. About the time that I had just returned from Europe and Bible lands, and I actually came home a day early because I had been asked by the widow of Audie Murphy, the most decorated hero of World War II, to take his funeral as he'd been killed in a plane crash. And I had known his wife as she had been attending the church I served in Los Angeles for over 10 years. And I saw this young woman as she came to a knowledge of Christ and then began to grow in grace and in the knowledge of Christ. Now, she wanted me to present a gospel message at the funeral service. And it was made very clear to me I'd be in enemy territory. Now, the chaplain there, and he was a very fine man, sound in the faith, he was asked to give the obituary notice, and the eulogy. And he did as it was proper. He mentioned the Distinguished Service Cross. He mentioned all of the medals that this young man had received. And I want to tell you, he deserved every one of them. He was a brave young man. He was the outstanding hero of World War II. He deserved every bit of it. But when I got up, I presented the gospel that men are saved not by anything they do, but something that God has done. And God has us all shut into a cross, and he's not asking the world to do anything. He's just asking the world one question: what will you do with my son who died for you? And that was the all-important question. And though this man had heard the gospel, and he had the example of his wife before him and all of that, and also the testimony of his two sons, he had not accepted it publicly as far as we know. But in that awesome and traumatic moment when that plane was plunging to the ground, that all of that must have come before him. He knew the facts of the gospel, and that if in that moment he turned to Christ, he was saved. And he saved as much as anybody's ever been saved. Because the Lord Jesus said, him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. And friends, may I say to you that the thief on the cross, while the Roman Empire said he wasn't fit to live in the Roman Empire, and they were executing him, the Lord Jesus said, I'm going to make you fit for heaven, and today thou shalt be with me in paradise. God takes lost sinners like I am, like you are, and brings you into the family of God, makes you a son of God. And he does it because of his death upon the cross. and not because there's anything in us or any merit in us whatsoever. That's the great message of Romans, and this is the message. It was Godet, the Swiss commentator, who said, "The Reformation was certainly the work of the Epistle to the Romans, and that of the Galatians also. And it is probable that every great spiritual renovation in the church will always be linked, both in cause and in effect, to a deeper knowledge of this book." It was Martin Luther who wrote, "The Epistle to the Romans is the true masterpiece of the New Testament and the very purest gospel, which is well worth and deserving that a Christian man should not only learn it by heart, word for word, but also that he should daily deal with it as the daily bread of men's souls. It can never be too much or too well read or studied, and the more it's handled, the more precious it becomes and the better it tastes." It was Chrysostom, one of the early church fathers, who had it read to him twice a week. Coleridge said that the Epistle to the Romans is the most profound writing that exists. And you find that actually one of the great scientists turned to this book, and he found in it that it gave a real faith. It was Michael Faraday. And this man was asked on his deathbed by a reporter, said, "What are your speculations now?" He says, "I have no speculation." He says, "My faith is firmly fixed in Christ my Savior, who died for me, who's made a way for me to go to heaven." This is the epistle that turned that Bedford tinker by the name of John Bunyan. I walked through the cemetery where he's buried, and I thought of what that man had done and said. You know, he was no intellectual giant, and he was not a poet, but he happened to write a book, my friend, that only one book has ever exceeded it in sales. That's the Bible, and it's Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress. May I say to you that it's the story of a sinner that's saved by grace, and that sinner was John Bunyan. And the record, it just happens to be that this man read and studied the Epistle to the Romans, and he told its story, its profound story, in his own life story, the story of Pilgrim, of how he came to the cross and the burden of sin rolled off. And he began that journey